Good morning.
Good morning.
And Merry Christmas. I have just a few invitations to extend to you. I would invite you to join us tomorrow evening at either 4 o'clock, 7 o'clock, or 11 o'clock. At 4 o'clock, our gathering is an informal, impromptu pageant. It is for the youngest members of our community and families particularly. All of you are welcome, but it is a service geared to young children. At 7 o'clock, we welcome you to a service much like our Sunday morning gatherings. The choir will be singing. We'll be doing a candlelighting ritual. We'll share a time for all ages, sing carols, and offer a reflection. Our evening ends at 11 o'clock in a quiet carol candlelight communion gathering, and we invite you to be with us at any or all of those times when we gather tomorrow evening. If you're not in the Edmonton area or can't be with us in person, please join us online. The 7 o'clock and the 11 o'clock gatherings will be live streamed, and we'd welcome your presence with us in that way. And if you're looking for friends to gather with on New Year's Eve, you're welcome to gather with us here from 6 until 10. It will be a time to share some food, to play some games together, to have an informal and casual way to celebrate the end of 2018 and to welcome 2019. It would save effort if you're able to bring your own plates and cutlery, so no one has to spend any time in the kitchen cleaning up. And there's a sign-up sheet on the foyer, or speak with Bernie Hardeen for more information. Bernie's just at the back doors there this morning. And coming in January, what comes to everyone in January? Debt. And a chance to reflect on debt. Is it more than a four-letter word? Three evenings together with Dave Jobson beginning January 14th. And there's more details about that coming, and there's more on our website and in the e-messenger. So please take an opportunity to consider joining us for one or all of those evenings.
Mark Nepo wrote that I've learned that if we can stay true to our experience and to each other, and face the spirit that experience and love carry, we will eventually be reduced to joy. Today, on this last Sunday before Christmas, we have the pleasure of experiencing joy, discussing joy, exploring this theme of joy as a theme of Christmas, and with the help of our instrumentalists, our choir, and with readings and reflections that may help us enter into the experience of joy more fully, that we might acknowledge that we have been reduced to joy in this season. As we gather here in this space, we recognize that we gather on Treaty 6 territory. We gather in the long tradition of those who have been here on this land, making use of it, making space for each other. We share gratitude for the long history of the indigenous communities that have called this home and all those of us who call this our adopted home. And we gather here on this time with gratitude and awe. It is in this spirit of Advent and in this December leading up to Christmas that we've celebrated many themes that are associated with this time of year, not the least of which has been joy and compassion, hospitality and hopefulness. And when we gather, we are always seeking to add more light to our experience, more light to our lives. Let's sing our way into this time with each other. Waiting for more light.
The stories of this season have inspired so much music over so many centuries, songs that evoke our hopes and our dreams, our fears, our loneliness, music that expresses the range of our emotions and our experiences as humans. Amid December story days, we've been counting our way toward Christmas as we've lit a candle each week each flame on our table, a way of making our way through the dark. We relight the first candle of Advent, a candle for hopefulness, a spark for all that is possible. And we relight the second candle of Advent, candle of compassion, that we might bring kindness to a world that knows more than its share of cruelty. And we light the third candle of Advent, candle for hospitality. In a time that can feel most inhospitable. And today we light a candle for joy. For that deep place within us that isn't dependent on circumstances, that word that is at the very root of our banner, that we might be rooted in joy in this season. Today we light these candles as more light returns to our hemisphere to lengthen our days, and as we come towards this festival we call Christmas, festival of light and of hope.
May I ask you to help me answer a question from your own experience and your own lives? Can you tell me, what kind of things make you happy?
My life is full of pain.
Oh, no. Should I believe you, Robert? Okay. What makes you happy?
Mm-hmm. Baking.
What makes you happy? Mm-hmm. Everything? Lovely. Pardon? Your teddy? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Art? Playing with your sister? Anyone else have any ideas? Yes? Another thing? With your Paw Patrol. Mm-hmm. That's fun. Well, there's lots of things that make us happy. Some things that don't, but lots that do. And I want to read you a story called The Jar of Happiness. This is by Elsa Burrows. You know about jars of happiness? Oh, lovely. Here we go. Once there was a little girl called Meg who invented her own kind of happiness. It tasted of chocolate ice cream, apple juice and sunshine, and it smelled of warm cookies and the ocean. It was red, yellow, and all of the other best colors. Meg took it everywhere with her. Look, in the bath, on her bike. She took it to her friend Zoe, who was feeling a little glum. It cheered up Oma, who didn't feel well. Using that jar as a drum, huh? Meg shared it with Leon, too, though only when he was being nice to her. Sounds like a little brother to me. One morning, Meg could not find her jar of happiness. Oh, dear. She looked.
Oh, my God, that's the weirdest place ever.
Yeah. And she looked. And looked and looked, but she couldn't find the jar anywhere.
It's literally right beside you.
Well, have you ever lost anything and it's actually right beside you? That happens to me all the time. Oh, dear. Where could it be? Oh, this is making Meg also now quite glum. Meg visited Zoe, who showed her how to make happiness out of smiles. She visited Oma, who gave her a bit of happiness made from hugs and tickles. And Leon explained how thinking happy thoughts can scare away gloomy feelings, bad smells, and even monsters. By the end of the day, Meg still hadn't found her jar.
It's right under your bed.
I know, it's under her bed.
Kitty,
I know, I think the kitty needs it, yes. She still hadn't found her jar, but she had found plenty of happiness. That's the end of that short little story. Ooh, it gets applause. I just want to say one more thing before we're done with this story, and that is that happiness, that feeling inside, that warm, glowy, smiley, joyous feeling, sometimes the things that we think make us happy, they go away, and so we have a hard time then feeling happy. So we have to be constantly looking for new ways to experience that joy and that feeling. We can look for new ways. Meg found a few new ways. We can all find new ways to make that feeling and that experience of joy and happiness come right down from inside of us and bubble up. And that's our job every day, is to find ways to help it bubble up. So we don't need a jar, because what if we lose it? We can find other ways to make that happiness and joy come right from within us. So now, you're right, it's time for Kid Spirit. Thank you for coming and sharing this story. Have a wonderful time this morning. There's preschool. There's Kid Spirit. Have a good morning. This is a writing of Charlotte Erickson, author, poet, and artist. I get so damn lonely and sad and filled with regret some days. It overwhelms me as I'm sitting on the bus watching the golden leaves from a window. A sudden burst of realization in the middle of the night. I can't help it. I can't stop it. I'm alone, as I've always been, and sometimes it hurts. But I'm learning something. I'm learning to breathe deep through it and keep walking. I'm learning to make things a little bit nicer for myself. To comfort my own heart when I wake up sad. I'm learning to find small bits of friendship in a crowd full of strangers. I'm learning to find a small moment of joy in a blue sky, in a trip somewhere not so far away, in a long walk on an early morning in December, or in a handwritten letter to an old friend simply saying, "I thought of you. I hope you're well." I'm learning that no one will come and save me. No one will come riding on a white horse and take anyone's worries away. You have to save yourself little by little. Day by day, build yourself a home, take care of your body, find something to work on, something that makes you excited, something you want to learn. You have to get yourself some books and learn them by heart. Get to know the author, where she grew up, what books she read herself. You have to take yourself out for dinner. You have to dress up for no one but you and simply feel nice. It's a lovely feeling to feel special. You don't need anyone to confirm it. I do get so damn lonely and sad and filled with regret some days, but I'm learning to breathe deep through it and keep walking. I'm learning to make things a little nicer for myself, slowly building myself a home with the things that calm me, that comfort me, with a plan to follow when things get dark, with a few people I try to treat right. I don't sometimes, but it's my intent to do so. I'm learning. I'm learning to create joy for myself. I'm trying, and I always will. In the words of this writer, may we find wisdom for our living. Joy is one of those deceiving words. It seems so easy and carefree. That seems like it would be the most natural of all of our Christmas themes. Compassion, well, most of us have to work awfully hard at being open to others. It's heart-tiring and heart-wrenching. Hospitality, in the same way, it's often a choice that runs counter to our desire, at times, to lock the door and curl up. Peace, well, we look around and realize that's a steep hill. And so we think when we get to joy, oh good, an easy one. It should be a piece of cake to exhibit joy. And yet somehow our spiritual journeys are anything but simple and easy. They seem to never have a day off. These spiritual lives that we live never seem to have an easy day or something on which we can just coast. But because life is complicated, so is joy. Because not all days are sunny and smooth, because we're all different people with different constitutions, with different things that make us feel joyous, that help us to embrace what's deep inside us, that joy that can bubble up, as I said earlier. There are decidedly times when joy is not natural. Perhaps that's why it's a classic pre-Christmas theme. It's one, like all the rest, that requires our constant attention and work. Henry Nouwen has said, joy does not simply happen to us. We have to choose joy and keep choosing it every day. And Charlotte Erickson, our author, shares in her very honest and vulnerable writings that there is no thing or no body that will do for her what she must do for herself. And she's learning bit by bit and day by day to care for herself and seek and choose what will bring something, what will bring some excitement, calm, comfort, glimpses of joy to her life, and to be on the lookout for them. A puddle, a note to a friend, a night out just for herself. These are the things that help us find joy, even when we're not feeling it. André Gide, a French philosopher, has written that it's a gift to know that joy is rarer and more difficult and more beautiful than sadness. Once you make the discovery that joy is rare, you must embrace joy as your human obligation. If in fact our sadness influences our joy and our joy influences our sadness, then choosing joy every day is our intention to allow transformation to enter our lives. It's us choosing in every action and every stolen moment of wonder and awe to allow our failures and our grief and our challenge to mean something. To know that none of it will stand in the way of a little bit of joy bubbling up. That we might save ourselves little by little. And in the process, create joy for ourselves and maybe for the world.
The words of Mary Oliver in her poem, Mindful. Every day,
yeah.
Wouldn't you like every day to start like that? This video wants to play before this poem, so we're going to let it do that. Thank you. Now we can hear the words. Mindful by Mary Oliver. Every day, I see or hear something that more or less... I know, it was doing it to me before we started. That's why I handed you the... Yeah, let's stay with the... We kind of need that picture in front of us anyway. I'm going to try this again. And while I'm at it, Art, I wonder if we could just fix this mic a little bit. It sounds like I'm inside a tin can. Maybe even if we just lower the sound a bit. That's sounding a bit better. Thank you. Okay, every day I see or hear something that more or less... kills me with delight, that leaves me like a needle in the haystack of light. It's what I was born for, to look, to listen, to lose myself inside this soft world, to instruct myself over and over in joy and acclamation. Nor am I talking about the exceptional, the fearful, the dreadful, the very extravagant, but of the ordinary, the common, the very drab, the daily presentations. Oh, good scholar, I say to myself, how can you help but grow wise with such teachings as these? The untrimmable light of the world, the ocean's shine, the prayers that are made out of grass. In the words of this contemporary poet, may we find wisdom for our living. So what better instructor in joy could there be than children and dogs? I think everything I know about joy I learned from living with dogs. Whether it's that happy dance of greeting they do when someone walks through the door, or that unabashed day at the same old food appearing in the dish day after day, or the unrestrained energy for whatever is at the other end of the leash. Joy abounds. And sometimes joy is simply in losing themselves to a scent or feeling the wind in their face as they run freely. What amazes me is their ability to experience joy in so many simple and unsophisticated things that are just part of the rhythm of daily life. And maybe that comes from a purity of spirit or the capacity to live almost entirely in the present tense. Unlike us, they don't seem to grieve time's tale ahead of time. The joy of the morning walk isn't diminished by the fact that every day it gets followed by being left home alone for the rest of the day. There's a great capacity to be captured and raptured by the moment of the present, the moment that delights, and finding an eternity within it. Children remind us that we were born with a capacity for joy. No one had to teach us delight. It came naturally, and we found it in the simplest things, like this child in the bathtub. We could find it over and over again in the same thing. Joy wasn't lost to its repetition. It was found in the simple delight and the contagion of sharing the joy with another. So here we are in the midst of this storied season, that in our hemisphere is always celebrated in the cold and dark of winter. A story that is set in a dark and dangerous time. And into the midst of the fearful characters we meet every Christmas, there is always that character who bursts on the scene to dispel fear and instruct in joy. Every year, the story always brings us the one who says, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news of great joy, which shall be for all the people." And it's not just in the midst of this ancient tale that we're schooled in joy. But like the poet reminded us, we were born for joy. To look, to listen, to lose myself inside this soft world, to instruct myself over and over again in joy. Nor am I talking about the exceptional, but of the ordinary, of the common, the very drab, the daily presentations. 'Tis the season to instruct ourselves again and again in joy. And it takes a kind of root discipline to resist being numbed, to root ourselves in those moments that could kill us with delight, to be anchored in what is good and true and beautiful and life-giving, and to give our attention and our energies to the shining moments as we enter the returning light and all the gifts of this season. How will we nourish our childlike wonder and recover our joy? How will we enliven those capacities that will help us to do what we were born for? To love fully. To love deeply.
Might we join our voices together as we share our intentions to strengthen them with each other, to speak them aloud, that they might become real for us, that we might pray these words. In this story, season of legends and myths, songs and symbols, may we rediscover our capacities for curiosity and joy. We gather to be inspired to live kindly, find the miracles in the ordinary, discover birth where we least expect it, and recover our sense of wonder in the midst of trouble and beauty. Be so.
I want to express gratitude on behalf of all of us for the gifts of this season that have been offered to us in music last Sunday with the Silvertones, today with the SSUC choir instrumentalists, our music directors and accompanists, those who offer us their gifts at the piano each week on our piano roster, all the gifts that you have brought us in this season. We are most grateful. Thank you. And a special thanks to those of you who prepared the meal and served the meal at Operation Friendship on Friday and continue our relationship with that community. There is an opportunity to support No Room in the Inn campaign again this Christmas, as we have done each year. Our Christmas Eve offerings at all three services go in support of the project, and this year those funds will be provided to youth empowerment and support services in order to provide safe and secure housing for homeless Edmonton youth. So you can make your gift payable in a check to SSUC and simply on the memo line write No Room in the Inn, and those funds will be part of our Christmas Eve offering that will be in support of the No Room in the Inn campaign. the opportunities to support us. We want to thank those of you that returned your financial commitments for 2019. That's a huge help for us in planning. If you haven't had an opportunity to do that yet, it's not too late. And if you didn't receive one, there's still some commitment letters on the table in the foyer. Each week there's an opportunity to help us by cash or checks in the box at the back, or supporting us online, buying grocery cards, they're available today in the foyer, or signing up for pre-authorized remittances. We take the light that we have shared here with one another, the light of our joy. Joy that isn't dependent on our circumstances in life, but is dependent on our choices and how we choose to frame and instruct ourselves in joy. And we go with that within us. We go to nourish the light of hope and joy where we find it in ourselves and in one another, in the stories of this season, and in all that is possible in the most ordinary and daily presentations of life. We go singing a carol we've been singing for a very long time. We sing it with some lyrics that are new and a tune that we've known since we were children.
Thank you.